seated.
Well, good morning, church. It's so good to see you this morning. Brother Danny, I think they're going to talk back to you this morning in that sermon. They're ready to worship. Wonderful. Guests, we want to say thank you for coming and joining us this morning and worshiping with us. We got two of our students standing. They've got a gift bag ready to give to you. So if you wouldn't mind raising your hand, they'd love to get that gift bag to you. It's got a visitor's card, a little coffee mug in there that you can enjoy your coffee with in the morning. And so we want to thank you for coming and joining us. Thank you, ushers. Thank you, guests, this morning. Church, let's open up our bulletins and look at our announcements. We have got a busy day today, a wonderful day of ministry. Following our service from 2 to 4, we have a baby shower. What an exciting time for Kyle and Kelsey. So please be sure to come and participate in that. At 4 o'clock, our Trail Life and American Heritage Girls will be meeting. At 5 o'clock, our deacons, 4:30, choir will need to be here. And then come on back and join us this evening and be blessed by our Easter musical. What a wonderful time of worship we will have this evening. Then tomorrow, men and women's Bible study tomorrow night at 6:30, and ladies' Bible study Tuesday morning at 9:30 a.m. Then Wednesday, getting back into the swing of things after spring break. Didn't feel much like spring over the weekend, did it? A little cold, but we'll have our regular Awana youth and adult and college Bible study Wednesday night. Then Sunshiners on Thursday, our Easter luncheon. You'll want to see those details over on the side of the bulletin to bring a side dish. Our very own Brother Ken Jones and Miss Mallory will be giving us special music. How wonderful. I'm looking forward to Thursday. It's going to be a great, great event for our Sunshiners. Then our Women's Spring event that's coming up on April 23rd. Just wanted to make sure that you can get sign up for that. You can call the office. You can scan the QR code. And just some details there. It is a free event. It does not cost you anything unless you want to have lunch catered for you, and that would cost $12. But you, ladies, you can bring your own lunch if you'd like. And then the missions project is completely voluntary, and you can see that detail there. So get signed up online or call us in the church office, and we'll get you signed up. Also have our senior adult rally there Thursday, April 8th. You can see that information. Boys and girls, an announcement for you. Vacation Bible School, Spark Studios. We are having a promotional registration. You want to get registered, okay, boys and girls? Because in the month of April, when you get registered in the month of April, that guarantees that you get your VBS t-shirt for free. Okay, so be sure to get registered for VBS. We are looking forward to Vacation Bible School this summer. It'll be a wonderful week of ministry. Also, we are in our season of giving of our Annie Armstrong Easter offering, and we have a video highlight of our missionary family, the Bird family from St. Louis, Missouri. So let's roll that video right now.
In St. Louis, there's a plethora of churches. One of the constant things that we kept hearing was new church. Why do we need a new church in this community? We already got a bunch of them not doing nothing.
In this neighborhood, I mean, there is a lot of homelessness, prostitution, fatherless homes.
The world has changed. Sin has increased. There's more crime. There's more drugs are prevalent. It's not a secret thing anymore.
My family and I bought a house in the community, and we moved there in the community. So the people that we wanted to reach, we were living amongst. We would set up on a Sunday, bring our own chairs, bring a barbecue pit, some chips, some hot dogs, and we would have worship service in the neighborhood park. And we just began to live there, love there, serve there, and people started to come. when we see people submitting to discipleship relationships, when we see people surrender their heart to Jesus, when we begin to see the neighborhood beginning to change around us, like, that's when we just know, like we're doing this right, and we wouldn't change it for the world. But it's gonna take all of us working together to ensure that lostness is being addressed in our communities.
It's the body of Christ. There's someone in Tennessee, they may never come to the inner city of St. Louis, but they can give and contribute because they believe in what we're doing as a body, as an entity, to help us to get to that next level.
We just gotta work together. We can do more together than we can do apart.
Church, the spirit of Southern Baptist is that we can do more together. And we are well on our way to doing more together. Our goal for our Annie Armstrong Easter offering is $20,000, and we're well on our way. Currently, we are at $13,705, and so we'll combine with those 40,000 other Southern Baptist church and raise $70 million. That's our national goal, to raise $70 million for North American missions. And we can do just that, more together. Our theme verse for our offering comes from Romans 15, verses 5 and 6. Now may the God of patience and comfort grant you to be like-minded toward one another, according to Christ Jesus, that you may with one mind and one mouth glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Church, will you join me as I pray? O Lord our God, we thank you for a beautiful Lord's Day. We come united to raise our voices in worship, to give praise, honor, and glory to the name that is above every name. The name Jesus. Jesus who died upon Calvary's cross that we may put away sin and put on righteousness. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Let's continue our time of worship. What good singing we had just a few moments ago as we thought about and sung about being washed in the blood of Christ. And as we begin to reflect on this week, above any other week, we know that Christ entered into Jerusalem with folks laying down palm branches and celebrating and singing Hosanna with anticipation and excitement of who Christ was and that he was coming into the city of Jerusalem. But in a matter of a few days, how things changed. How people then began to deny that they knew him, denied that they understood what he was doing. They decided that they wanted to kill him, and they thought that they were going to accomplish that goal by nailing him to the cross and crucifying him. But thank goodness God, being all-powerful and almighty, chose instead to allow his son to redeem us through death on the cross. And through that precious blood that was shed, and then allows us to celebrate that on Easter Sunday with a risen Savior, the only one who could die for our sins. And so this morning, I want us to reflect on just two verses this morning as we prepare to sing about what Christ has done for us at the cross. And it's very simple verses. One in which we quoted growing up, a lot of us did, from John 3:16. For God, you can say it with me, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but will have eternal life. It goes on to say in verse 17, for God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. That's the reason Christ came. That's the reason he died on the cross. That's the reason his precious blood was shed. So let's stand together and let's sing and focus on the cross of Christ this morning and what he did for us. ¶¶ God can be praised, that's okay. Amen. Praise the Lord. You may be seated.
Well, amen. I may go ahead and preach this morning. Tell you what, y'all sound great out there. If you have your bulletins, please open them. We'll look at our prayer list on the back page. Reminded we should pray and never give up from Luke chapter 18. Of course, today is Palm Sunday, the beginning of Holy Week, and so I encourage you to celebrate what the Lord Jesus Christ did for us by giving us such a great salvation through his death, burial, and resurrection. And I'd love for you to spend some time on that this next week. Think about the passion and love of our Lord Jesus Christ, and maybe go through Matthew or Mark or Luke or John as the week goes by and kind of walk the steps of the Lord. Maybe look at all of them this week as we celebrate what the Lord has done for us. Also want to continue to remember those who are our one, the one in your circle of influence that does not yet know Jesus Christ as Savior, and pray for them and seek an opportunity during this season in order to lead them to faith in Christ. We want to continue to pray for those in our church family. You see the list there. And the last one there, Alice Van, she's recovering from knee surgery, so we want to continue to remember her and the others. We want to continue to pray for our parents who are expecting children, and also extended family and friends. There's one we need to add there, and that's Roger Johnson's got some serious heart issues and having some tests run to see what the doctors think they can do for him. Under long-term care, you see a couple underlined. Miss Ripsamay Amari had two neck surgeries, one right behind the other this past week, and is still in Northeast Georgia Medical Center recovering, so pray for her. And also Joel Hall, most of you know he's been fighting the cancer battle for a while, and they've discovered he had some blockages in his leg, so he had to have some vascular surgery last week, and that's at Northside Forsyth Hospital, so be in prayer for him as well. We want to pray for our missionaries serving around the world, and again, during this season of the year, we are highlighting our North American Mission Board missionaries, and you just saw the highlights from Michael and Tracy Bird as she stands for some 3,000 others who are serving us and who are supported by our prayers and by the offering. And again, thank you for your generosity to give. Continue to pray for our nation and president and all that's going on in the world. We also want to pray for our families who are grieving. We have Chris Rodriguez and Amy. They're in Tampa today to bury Chris's parents, Patrick and Evelyn Rodriguez. Both of them died within short proximity of each other, and so they're having a double funeral down there today, so be in prayer for them. And also a friend of Andrea Howell, Todd Evans, pray for their his family. He's a pastor at First Baptist Church, Abbeville, Alabama, and died suddenly, leaving behind a wife and five children. So be in prayer for that family today as well as we go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we do thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, for this season of the year where we're reminded of how much you loved us. You loved us so much that you sent your son Jesus into this world to live and teach us how to live, and then go to Calvary's cross and die for our sins, and then rise again on the third day, offering eternal life and hope to all who put their faith and trust in him. And Lord, as we look at our prayer list and look at those who are suffering, look at those who are dying, Lord, we're thankful for that blessed hope that you give us. We pray today, if there's someone here that's never trusted Christ as their Savior, that today is the day that they would make him their Savior and their Lord, by repenting of their sins and asking Jesus Christ to come into their heart and life. Lord, bless us today as we continue to worship you. Lord, you are worthy for the great love in which you loved us. Bless us now as we continue to worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir, for leading us to worship the Lord this morning. And if you want to hear more like that, come back this evening at 6:30, and you'll hear the rest of the Easter musical that Brother Derek has led us to get ready for this evening. If you have your Bibles, please open to, I bet you thought I was going to say Matthew, 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Of course, today is Palm Sunday, when Jesus rode in Jerusalem and the crowd sang, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the Lord Jesus, our Messiah." But by the end of the week, they had changed their tune. They were saying, "Crucify him." And then what looked like an embarrassing display of weakness ended up becoming the power of God. And that's what we're going to look at today, the cross of Christ from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning in verse 18. "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, 'I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent.' Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made the foolish the wisdom of this world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For the Jews request a sign, the Greeks seek after wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. To the Jews a stumbling block, to the Greeks foolishness, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise among according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things that are mighty. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised God has chosen, and the things which are not, to bring to nothing the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him, that is of God, you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that as it is written, he who glories, let him glory in the Lord." And all the people said, amen. Amen. In 1 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul is writing to the Corinthian church that is having problems with division and disunity and disharmony. And Paul lists their problems as misplaced priorities, spiritual immaturity, and misplaced glory. In other words, they were trying to do God's work using the world's methods. How often do we do that? The world's way of doing business is competition. The world judges or ranks people with superlatives. Who's who? Who's the best? Who's the most? It's been a while since I've been in high school, but when I was in high school, the yearbooks every year had senior superlatives. Do they still do that? Who's the most attractive, the most intelligent, the most athletic, the most popular, the most likely to succeed? And this kind of competition doesn't end at high school. It continues on into life. And see, the problem is the world's way never leads to unity. We're too busy stepping on each other, trying to climb that ladder of success, to try to figure out who's bigger, who's better, who's best. Paul turns our attention and ours to the centerpiece of Christianity. He turns our attention to what brings unity to the Church of Jesus Christ, and that is simply the cross. You see that in verse 18. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. Verse 18, to the perishing, to the lost and dying world, the cross is foolishness. Verse 18, but to those who are being saved, the cross is the power of God. Verse 23, to the Jews, the cross is a stumbling block. Interesting Greek word for stumbling block is scandalon, from which we get the word scandal. In verse 23, it says, the Greeks or the Gentiles, the cross is foolishness. It's an interesting Greek word there too. It's morion, from which we get the word moron or moronic. That's what they thought it looked like. But verse 24, the believer, the cross is power. And the Greek word there is dunamon, from which we get the word dynamite. So that is the power of God that we see in this cross. Now, Paul starts off by describing why the world despises the cross. First of all, in verse 22, it says the world loves power. And that's what they were dealing with, the Jewish people. The Jewish people wanted signs. They wanted wonders. They wanted miracles. They wanted power. The Jews wanted a strong, spectacular Savior who overthrows the Romans and reestablishes the kingdom of David. Jewish hopes were high when Jesus came, feeding the multitudes, healing the sick, calming the storms, casting out demons, raising the dead. That's powerful. That was right up their alley. That's what they wanted. But you know, the problem is with people who love power and miracles, there's never quite enough. No matter how much Jesus did, they always wanted one more. Yesterday's miracles are quickly forgotten. All we need is just one more. So when Jesus stopped performing miracles and started talking about a cross, people began to dissociate from him. They began to distance themselves from him. They ran away in droves. When Jesus was hanging on the cross, he didn't look very powerful at all. Matter of fact, he looked extremely weak. So weak that the crowds begin to taunt in Matthew 27. He saved others, himself he cannot save. If he is the king of Israel, let him come down now off of that cross and we'll believe in him. You know, we love to blame the Jewish folks there, but we're made out of the same stuff. We love to follow conquerors, and champions, and winners. I remember General Patton said to his armies, he took command at the beginning of World War II, he was trying to pump up the troops who had already been defeated several times. And he said, when you were kids, you all admired the champion marble player, the fastest runner, the toughest boxer, the big league ball players, the all-American football players. Americans love a winner, and Americans will not tolerate a loser. But as the world looks across the Christ, we don't see a winner. We see a naked, nail-pierced, beaten, and bloodied Jesus. And the world thinks in their heart, and they say under their breath, this Jesus is a loser. There's no way he's the Savior of the world. See, the world loves power. Secondly, if you look back to verse 22, the world loves wisdom. The Greeks prided themselves on being smart, being sophisticated, being philosophical and logical. They excelled in math and science and art and astronomy and medicine and morality. They boasted they were ahead of all mankind in the search for truth. They were intrigued by the teachings of Jesus. They found, you know, him interesting and thought-provoking. They liked his parables. It was kind of like their own tragedies, which are stories with sad endings. And the Greeks also had comedies, which were stories with happy endings. But the cross to them was absurd. It was nonsense. It was foolishness. What was the point of a good man who should have had a happy ending to his life, dying with such a sad ending on the cross? What's the point of whosoever shall save his life shall lose it, and vice versa? You know, in our modern world, we give prizes to great thinkers. We give Nobel Prizes and Pulitzer Prizes, Oscars, Grammys, Emmys, Tonys, and probably a whole bunch of others. But you know, the world wouldn't offer Jesus any prize at all when they saw him on the cross. The third thing, if you'll look on over to verse 26, we'll see power and wisdom repeated, but it also says the world loves nobility. For whatever reason, we love celebrities. Regardless of how they came by their fame, we are intrigued by the lifestyles of the rich and famous. And even as Americans who fought a war of independence from the British some 246 years ago, we're still fixated on the British royal family. How long will the Queen live? Will Charles ever become a king? Will Prince Harry and Meghan ever be invited to the Windsor family reunion ever again? I've got another question. Why do we care? But anyway, but that's just the way we roll. You know, the world loves and fantasizes about the famous and the ones who we love, fame and fortune. It's just part of who we are. And that's why we read those tabloids at the grocery checkout counter, so we keep up with the movie stars and the sports stars and the rock stars, stars who could care less about us as long as we continue to buy tickets to their performance. But what is there to love about Jesus? He was not at the top of anything. He was born at the bottom. If you remember, he's born in a smelly stable in Bethlehem. He lived at the bottom. He hung out with the poor and preached to them and did work for them. He didn't live in a HGTV-style home. He died at the bottom as a common criminal, executed by capital punishment on a cross. He was buried at the bottom. Didn't even have his own tomb laid out. Had to borrow a tomb. So yes, verse 18, to the perishing, to the lost, to the dying world, the cross is foolishness. But to the saved, look at verse 30, the cross is wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Let's take those one at a time. First of all, the cross of Christ is wisdom. Realize mankind is always searching for truth, but the problem is, to quote Jack Nicholson in the movie A Few Good Men, the world can't handle the truth. As Paul wrote in 2 Timothy 3:7, the people of the world are always learning, but never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Paul wrote about this, and you know, our nation is a perfect example of this. You know, we've got some of the greatest research resources in the history of the world. We have more schools, colleges, and universities than any other nation on earth. We got a space program that put man on the moon. We got medical advances that keep people alive for nearly a century. Information superhighway, also known as the internet, puts millions of pieces of information at your fingertips from your nearest electronic device. But while we have so many resources in our search for truth, for whatever reason, we can't seem to find it. We're still not able to solve mankind's basic problem, and that is sin, sorrow, and death. That's our big problems, and so far we're not able to solve that one. The good news is that Jesus has answered our sin, sorrow, and death problem. He died on the cross to make atonement and offer forgiveness for the sin part, and then he rose again on the third day declaring victory over sorrow and death. So he has solved that. Jesus is the wisdom of God. He is the one who came to offer us the answer to life's ultimate questions, and that is, who am I and why am I here? And is there this life all there is? And if a man or woman die, will they live again? Verse 25, the cross of Christ proves that the foolishness of God is wiser than the wisdom of men. So our first point we see from the cross is wisdom. Look back to verse 30 and you'll see the second. The cross of Christ is righteousness. Not only does the cross show us God's wisdom, it also reveals God's righteousness, God's definitions of what's right and what's wrong. I remember back in the 1980s, I worked for Macy's in Atlanta. And at that time, Macy's Kansas City was having lots of problems. And I can't verify this story because I was not there, but it filtered back to us that the president of Macy's traveled to Kansas City to meet with all the senior management. When he got them all in the room there, he walked in and he didn't say a word. He simply laid down on the conference table, placed a rose on his chest, and laid there for a few moments looking like a corpse. He didn't say a word, but his message was clear. Things in the Kansas City division of Macy's were terribly wrong, and if things didn't change drastically and quickly, Macy's Kansas City was going to be dead. That's the message of the cross. The cross shows us in living color that we human beings are not right in the sight of God. The cross shows us the exceeding sinfulness of our sin. We live in a world that says there is no absolutes, that says there is no truth, that everything is relative. What might be true for me might be false for you. What might seem right to me might seem wrong to you. We can't seem to tell a difference in right from wrong. We've even reached a point we can't even tell the difference between male and female. But the cross is a stark reminder that God has defined, He has defined for us what is right and what is wrong. And when God calls something wrong, it's wrong. It's sin. And the Bible tells us that the wages of sin is death. And that's the bad news right there. And the good news of the cross is a big theological word called substitutionary atonement. Paul explains it for us in simple terms in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. He said, God the Father made Christ the Son to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. So did you get that? Made Jesus Christ sin to carry our sin so that we didn't have to die for that sin. That's what substitutionary atonement. He is stepping in our place, taking our sin so that we do not have to die for the penalty of that sin. You see, the bad news is God is right. We've done wrong. Wrong is sin. The consequences of sin is death. But the good news is Jesus loved you so much that he is willing to die in your place so that we could be made righteous, so that we could be made right with God. So the cross is wisdom, it's righteousness. Thirdly, look back to verse 30 and you'll see the cross of Christ is sanctification. Another big word. It means to be a saint, to be sanctified, to be holy. It means to be special. It means to be different from the world. It means to be set apart from the world in order to do work of God, in order to be to serve the Lord. And that's what we see at the cross of Christ. We see Jesus Christ being set apart, being different than the rest of the world, to come down here to do what we could not do. He was set apart by his submission to the will of his heavenly Father. Just think about this for a minute. Jesus didn't have to do all this. Jesus was an extraordinarily talented person. If he'd been in his high school, he would have been all superlative. He would have got all the pictures done there. You know, he was high school. He'd been most intelligent. If you remember, at the age of 12, he was debating all the theologians in the city of Jerusalem and coming out on top. He was no doubt the most athletic. How many of y'all can walk on water? So I think he takes the prize for being the most athletic, most likely to succeed. Who else can feed 5,000 people without even going to a grocery store? He could do it all. But the reason Jesus is on the cross is because of his submission to the will of the Father and the Father's plan of salvation to save lost mankind. And that's what he did. He was set apart by his submission. Not my will, but thine be done, he said before he went to the cross. Jesus was also set apart by his sacrifice. He was willing to give his all. He was willing to give his whole life to the will of the Heavenly Father. Not holding anything back, Jesus is sanctified and special because of his willingness to give whatever God required of him. And that includes his own life. But the good news is about sanctification, and you can write this one down. This is a quote. You can't outgive God. How many of you know that? How many of you experienced that? You can't outgive God. And so no matter how much the Lord requires of you to submit or to sacrifice, God giveth more grace. Even Jesus, who gave it all, Jesus gave it all here on the cross for our life, but God didn't allow that to go unnoticed. It says, Jesus humbled himself, became obedient to the point of death, even the death on the cross, it says in Philippians 2. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him a name above every name, that the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So again, you can't outgive God. He's going to give you more. And the same for us. If we are in holy sanctifying power is available to all of us who believe. Paul in 2 Timothy 2 writes, for if we died with him, then we shall live with him. If we suffer with him, we shall also reign with him. So again, regardless of what price the Lord asks us to pay in this life, it's nothing to be compared with the glory that's going to be revealed in us when we rise to be with our Savior Jesus Christ one of these days in heaven. So again, you can't outgive God. So we've looked at the cross being wisdom and righteousness and sanctification. Now number four, look back to verse 30, and the cross of Christ is redemption. Now we're not very familiar with that redemption term. It's kind of an ancient custom in Israel. If something happened to you in your life and you fell on hard times, you couldn't pay your bills, they didn't have a government welfare program back then. So what you had to do was you had to sell yourself into slavery in order to put food in your stomach and put a roof over your head. But thankfully, there was something called the law of redemption. The law of redemption meant if you had a near kinsman, a near relative, who had the ability to pay and the willingness to pay, they could buy you back. They could buy you out of slavery, out of the situation that you were in, and set you free. How many of y'all got a good uncle like that? I don't know too many do, but in ancient times, that was the law of redemption. If you had someone that lived that was near kin to you, they could get you out of the terrible mess that you found yourself in. But, you know, it ends up being the story of our salvation based on that kind of redemption. Since the original sin in the Garden of Eden, Adam's sin nature has been genetically transmitted to all human beings, and all of us are born with a birth defect known as a sin nature. And as soon as you are capable of moral action, it says in the Baptist Faith and Message, as soon as you're able to make up your own mind and make your own choices, guess what? You choose against God, and you choose to do wrong. You choose to sin. And so that puts you in a very serious situation. It leaves us with those three terminal problems: sin, sorrow, and death. And don't you wish we had a near kinsman? Don't you wish we had the rich uncle, a near relative who is qualified, willing, able to save us from this slavery of sin and let us go free? But the problem is, who in their right mind would be willing to do that? Because what is the price for our sin? The wages of sin is death. So who's willing to... Do anybody have an uncle that's willing to die for you? Well, the good news on this particular day is that we do have a near kinsman. The cross of Christ means redemption. Jesus is qualified. In Christ, God became one of us. Matter of fact, that's what they called him when he was born. Emmanuel, which means what? God with us. He came down, became one of us. He became a near relative for you so that he could pay the price for your sin and so that you could go free. Next thing is, okay, so he's qualified. Well, is he able? Is Christ able to pay that? Well, yes, he's unique in that. John 10:18 says, since he's the Son of God, he has the ability to lay his life down. He also has the ability to raise his life up again. And see, I can lay my life down. I just don't have the ability to raise it back up again. But see, Jesus is qualified and able because he is able to do that. And is he willing? The answer is yes. The question is, why would Jesus be willing to do that? Simply because he loves you. Isn't that a wonderful thing? Yeah. Not asking you to pay anything back. He just simply chose to do this because he loves you. At the cross, Jesus has been our kinsman redeemer. He's freeing us from death, forgiving our debts, breaking the chain of canceled sin. He reconciles us. He restores us into a close personal relationship with the God who made us. So let's see where we're at now on this. Believers, the world sees what the cross as weakness and foolishness, but the believer sings, oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For it was on that old cross that Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. And I will cling to that old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Amen? Now let's look at that last verse. Verse 31 says, always remember the glory. Don't sit around sobbing about the cross. The Christian should be glorying in that cross because that's where our salvation comes from. That's where our restored relationship with God. That's where our ticket back to the Garden of Eden comes in. So we should glory in what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for that. We should make our boast in the cross because even though the world may scorn that old cross, the cross of Christ is our power, it's our wisdom, it's our righteousness, it's our sanctification, it's our redemption. And that's why Paul would say in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, that I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. We know we're supposed to glory in that cross, but how often do we forget about the cross? How often do we take the cross for granted? And that takes us back to this book here, 1 Corinthians. Just like this church here at Corinth, instead of measuring ourselves by the cross of Christ, they begin to measure themselves by the world standards. If you read all of chapter 1, you'll find out that inside the church, the Corinthians were fussing because I'm a better Christian than you are, 99. Now, that never happens at Northlake, though. I'm thankful for that. But, that can tend to happen in churches, and that's what's going on here at Corinth. Some were saying, well, I'm friends of Apollos. Well, I'm friends of Paul. Well, I'm friends of Peter. Well, Peter baptized me. Well, Apollos baptized me. Well, Paul baptized me. Well, here we go. Let's get into a bidding war. I've been a member longer than you. I give more money than you. That was what was going on inside the church. When they got outside the church, they wanted to be popular and approved and accepted by the world. And since the cross is weak and foolish, they never mention the cross. And we too, like Corinth of old, can become ashamed of the gospel and ashamed of the cross. And sometimes even if we do build up the courage to witness to some unchurched friend and try to get them to come to church, we're more likely to give a worldly invitation. We ask them, would you like to come to our church? I don't know. Why should I come to Northlake? Well, we have good food. Every time we get together and have a covered dish dinner, we got some excellent cooks at Northlake, so we'd love for you to come and share a meal with us. We have some great fellowship. We got some really nice people. They love to joke around with you, and we're just fun folks to be around. And another thing is we have lots of fun. Our children, youth departments, they have a lot of good things for the kids, so why don't y'all come on down to Northlake? Well, all that sounds well and good, but you know, you can say the same thing about McDonald's. No, the reason you ought to come to Northlake, the reason you ought to come to any church is because of the preaching of the gospel. You ought to come to the church because of the preaching of the cross, because of the bad news that the wages of sin is death. You need to come because of the good news that the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. The reason you ought to come to our church is because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, Jesus Christ, to die for your sins on Calvary's cross so that you would not have to perish in a place called hell but could spend forever with the Lord in a place called heaven. That's the preaching of the gospel. That's the preaching of the cross. And that's why you ought to come to Northlake. And by the way, we do have good cooks. Okay, so. But that's not why you ought to come. I'm not just picking on you, though. Preachers, too, are tempted to conform to the world. Even the Apostle Paul had to learn this lesson. If you remember back in Acts chapter 17, Paul happened to be in Athens, Greece, not Georgia. But both of them were university towns. And he was out there among the professors and philosophers and no doubt became a little intimidated by all these educated people that were around him. So he tried talking to them a little comparative religion. He tried talking to them a little philosophy, a little bit of Greek poetry he salted in there. And the result is very little happened. Very little spirit, very little power. After Athens, Paul's next stop was Corinth. And at Corinth, he gave up trying to preach with academic articulation and worldly sophistication. He chose instead to preach the cross. Look at chapter 2 if you still got your Bibles open. Paul says, I, brethren, when I came to you, I did not come to you with excellency of speech or of wisdom declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I was with you in weakness and fear and in much trembling, and my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Amen. Paul learned to preach the cross. Whether the world likes it or not, whether they think it's wise or not, for there is the power of God. I remember when I was in seminary years ago, our theology professor actually told a story on himself. He was a former missionary to Japan before he became a professor at the seminary. He said when he first arrived in Japan, he was asked to travel with a local pastor and preach revivals in various cities, various churches in Japan. He said at that time his command of the Japanese language was limited, but he prepared and translated some theologically sound sermons. He said the meetings were well attended, but the meetings were spiritually dead. He said, to tell you the truth, that's just what happened. Nothing happened. And he said the Japanese pastor, very respectfully, offered him a suggestion. Why don't you preach on the cross of Christ? He said, I was so ashamed, a Southern Baptist trained missionary, and I have to be told when I preach a revival message to preach about the cross of Christ. How often do we forget that? I also feel the pressure to preach on something else. Because of all the preacher jokes out there, y'all know the jokes about the preachers who preach too long, and the sermons are too boring, the sermons are irrelevant, so most preachers are tempted to jazz up our sermons with some jokes, whether they apply to anything you're talking about or not, or some cute stories or some human interest things that's going on out there. And we omit the cross. I think we preachers need to follow the advice of the great 19th century preacher Charles Spurgeon, who said, wherever I take my text, whether it's in the Old Testament or the New Testament, I immediately make a beeline for the cross. You hadn't preached the sermon unless you make a beeline for the cross. You got to at least finish with the cross. Yes, there's other things that Christians need to know, and yes, we need to teach the whole counsel of God, but it ain't a sermon until you tell them about the cross of Christ. Amen. See, we see our problem at the cross, sin, and at the same time, when you're looking at the cross, you see the solution, and his name is Jesus. So let's conclude. Christians are not called to argue about who's biggest, best, and most. Christians are called to unity, and unity is found at the cross because the ground is level at the foot of the cross. I remember we had kind of a high-profile funeral since I've been here, and I got a call from some of the uppity-ups in the community around here and asked would there be any VIP seating at Northlake. And I said, yes, everybody at Northlake is a VIP. The ground is level at the foot of the cross. At the cross, all sinners are confronted with their sin nature that screams out the Elvis song, I did it my way, instead of I did it God's way. The cross says my way results in sin and death. At the cross, we discover that we are saved by the grace of God alone. In the face of death, we have nothing to offer. That's why we sing, just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. At the cross, we're overwhelmed with the idea that if Jesus was willing to endure all that suffering to be my Savior, then is it really a small thing for me to make him my Lord? When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, love so amazing, so divine, demands my heart, my life, my all. The cross of Christ forces you to a mental and spiritual crossroads where a decision has to be made. Am I going to live my life my way, or am I going to follow the way of the cross? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for your word. On this day, as we reflect back to that Holy Week, we thank you, Lord, for your willingness to go to Calvary's cross for a sinner such as I. Thank you, Lord, for being my kinsman redeemer who is willing to pay the price so that I could go free. We pray if there's someone here this morning that's never yet trusted you by simple faith. Lord, you could ask us to do so many things to try to qualify for what you did for us on the cross, but you've made it simply grace through faith. Grace, you offered yourself to us, and faith, we extend our hand to receive it. And we pray this morning, if someone here has never trusted Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, that today is the day that they would repent of their sins, asking Jesus to be their Savior and Lord. Lord, for those of us who are Christians, Lord, forgive us when we get ashamed of the gospel, that we can talk about everything else to our friends, but we never can get around to finding out if they know Christ and sharing the gospel of Christ about the cross of Christ. Lord, help us to recommit ourselves, especially in this late hour in a world that desperately needs to hear you, to share the essence of this week, the cross, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Now's our time of invitation. Our altar's open if you need to come and pray. And you can come down here and pray and know that there'll be praying people all over the building that are ready to pray for you without knowing your business. But ask the Lord to bless you in whatever's going on in your life. If you've never trusted Jesus Christ, your Savior, I'll be standing down front. I would love to talk with you and share with you from the Word of God how you can know Jesus as your Savior. Maybe you've already prayed and asked Jesus to come into your heart and save you, but you haven't made a public profession of faith by joining the church and being baptized. And again, you don't need to be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You need to glory in what he has done for you. So won't you do that? Maybe you've been saved and baptized and your membership is somewhere else and you've moved to this community and you feel like the Lord is leading you to join our church. Won't you do that today? Maybe he's got some other kind of calling on your life. Listen to him as he speaks to your heart and respond to him in faith. As we stand together and sing our hymn of invitation, won't you come? I am. We still got folks up here praying, so if you bow your head, close your eyes, it's not too late to make a decision. If the Lord is speaking to your heart, won't you say yes to Him right now? Thank you for being here today. Thank you for your attention, for your prayers. And don't forget to share this glorious gospel that we're supposed to glory in the Lord. So share this glorious gospel with a world that desperately needs to hear it. Just wanted to recognize, I think we got Brett Ernest here with us today. For those of you who don't remember, COVID almost laid him really low. He was in the valley of the shadow. And the Lord blessed him and answered our prayers and restored him to life. And so we're thankful that his pulmonologist and lung doctors have said that they think he's well enough to start mixing with folks again. So we're glad to have you back today, Brett, and what a blessing it is. I'm going to ask Brother Harry, if you will, to dismiss us in prayer.
Let us pray. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day, the message that we've heard, and the freedom to worship you. Sing your praises. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, our ever-present help in trouble, our rock. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. We love you, Lord. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.